Burnett, and we just thank you for being here. Let's say our opening prayer, which will be printed up here if you don't already know it. Lord God, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for everything that you give us. Open our hearts to receive your gifts. May we all be blessed with all your gifts during the coming year. Okay, I think we're gonna have a song. We are unity.
I have a dream, a dream of what I wanna be. I wanna be free. That's what my heart keeps telling me. Give me your hand,
we'll find a way.
There's people out there
that feel the same.
If we help each other, I just know we can succeed. We are one, but we are different. We from all find a way. People out there
that feel the same.
If we help each other,
I just know we can succeed.
We are one.
Now together recite unity's foundational principle. There is only one power, one presence, active in the universe and in my life. God, the good, the omnipotent. And when we live this principle, we are a thriving spiritual community here to inspire one another to realize God's love. Centered in the Spirit of God, we see peace, love, and abundance in an awakening world. And the daily word today is serve. And I also want to mention in conjunction with that, that tomorrow our nation will be celebrating Martin Luther King Day. And Martin Luther King Jr. served the country in a way where he tried to promote peace among the races. So I'm going to, after I read the Daily Word, share a couple of his quotes. All right, now, for January 14th, the word is serve. I bring God's love into the world through service. We don't need special skills to be of service. I have willing hands and an open heart and channels of love to be directed wherever they are most needed. The impulse to serve is my compassionate nature seeking expression. I respond to the needs around me by doing what I can to help. I do not think about reward or recognition. I just know that service fills my heart. Serving is a wonderful way to feel close to God. My loving heart is open, my hands are busy, and my life is filled with purpose when I'm doing what I can to brighten another person's life or to make the world a better place. I feel God's presence strongly as I serve and share the love and the care of the divine. Martin Luther King Jr. would agree with all that. One of his quotes was, life's most persistent question is, what are you doing for others? So, you know, in our community here at church, there are many opportunities to serve, to be a greeter when people come in the morning, to serve on the refreshment committee where you help provide refreshments. And you don't have to have a high degree of education to serve. One of the other quotes from Dr. King is, everybody can be great because everybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree. You don't have to have the subject and the verb of your sentence match. All you need is a heart full of grace and a soul that's generated by love. So that pretty much includes all of us. And it doesn't matter in what way you serve, whether you consider it a lowly position or a high position. Another quote from Dr. King is, if a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep the streets like Michelangelo painted, or like Beethoven composed music, or like Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep the streets so well that the hosts of heaven and earth will pause and say, here was a great sweeper, and he did its job well. Okay. We'll have, we already did that. So we're going to have another music before our meditation. And Reverend Lori, did I forget to say that? That was the end of the Daily Word. I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. Okay, now we're ready for a song.
Whatsoever you do to the least of my people, that you do unto me. When I was hungry, you gave me to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me to drink. Now enter into the home of my Father. Whatsoever you do to the least of my people, that you do unto me. When I was homeless, you opened your door. When I was naked, you gave me your coat. Now enter into the home of my Father. Whatsoever you do to the least of my people, that you do unto me.
When I was weary, you helped me find rest. When I was anxious, you calmed all my fears. Now enter into the home of my Father.
Whatsoever you do to the least of my people,
warming up. Aren't you glad you're not shoveling snow? We can take this, can't we? I may have to go home and rake, but I don't have to shovel. So we're going to do what I like to do at the beginning of the year, It's a meditation on the power of faith, what Myrtle would call a prayer treatment. So I invite you to get very comfortable in your chair. Take off anything from your lap that might distract you. For those of you at home enjoying this cold day in the comfort of your recliner, I invite you to just kick your feet up, take a load off, and relax. Take in some nice, deep, cleansing breaths, just reminding the body that it's a time for stillness and release and strengthening. Close your eyes if you like, and just let go. Let go of anything you brought into this sacred space with you, any worries, any troubles, any thoughts of tomorrow. Let that all slip away. This is your time. Your time with God. And as you relax, allow yourself to go inward into that inner landscape, that sacred temple. The more time you spend in here, the more familiar you become with Spirit's urgings and promptings, the more comfortable you feel in this space of God, the more intimate your dialogue and communion becomes, and you become so familiar with this sweet, soft voice that you rely on it in full faith to lead you through anything. So just relax in that knowing of the depth of love God has for you. And feel that warm glow, that guiding light that constantly pours through you, renewing, restoring, relieving, strengthening. Focus particularly on the top of your skull, on the top of your brain. Imagine the beautiful color blue, royal blue, bright royal blue, piercing, strong, bold. Imagine those two hemispheres of brain in you, amazingly created by the master of all creation, specifically for you. Each side serving a purpose, and when in balance, you become whole and firm. In the center of those two lobes and down towards the base of the neck, there is a gland called the pineal gland. It is represented by the power of faith. Just imagine this blue light filling both hemispheres of the brain. Feel the intensity of that blue, soothing yet empowering. The left side of the brain responsible for logic and getting us from one space to another, figuring things out. On the right side, a conduit for God's thoughts, images. And these two together meet at this space in perfect balance. And in your heart, feel, I am God's amazing child. I am created in that image of pure love. I am strengthened and balanced. You'll feel this blue color. It may be pulsating,
may be growing in intensity or softening. Just observe. Is this a point in our body, like a median in the chakra, where there is a concentration of power? We can use this in our practice and allow that power center to expand and fill the entire cranial area, releasing old thoughts, releasing worn out neurons and fibers and cells. And as we release those, new energy gushes in, having faith that we are restored. We open fully to guidance and perception, understanding and wisdom. And there is a strand of energy, you may feel it from that space between the brains, coming down through your throat in this whole area. Just observe the area of the neck and throat if there is any tightness. Focus on those areas and release. Allow that light to continue to stream down through your sternum, releasing, relaxing, letting go. Down throughout the chakras to your areas of the lower back, releasing any tension. Now this upper part of your body will feel balanced as that light spreads out through your chest, through your arms, through your rib cage, down your spinal cord, releasing, relaxing, and strengthening. And in your heart, feel, I am strong. I am whole. I am a bright light of God, shining brilliantly in that knowledge. Feel God loving you, holding you, strengthening you, simply knowing how precious you are. How precious you are. Releases any negative charge, relaxes muscles. Continue to feel that beautiful light as it beams through your body, shining brightly, restoring strength and energy. Feel it in your hips, your thighs, your knees, releasing, relaxing. Through your calves and shins, ankles and feet, feel your fingers may be tingling with new energy as you remember to whom you belong. You relax fully in that knowing with pure faith. God has got you. You need not worry or even think. God's got this. That sweet knowing brings back memories. Memories of who you know you are, the brilliant, beautiful, amazing child, here to play and enjoy, to see above the fray and the madness, to see clearly how easy it can be. Feel your heart lightening up, your whole body lighter, filled with this energy. The possibilities are endless. Allow your whole body to feel hope and joy and blessings. In your heart, remember, I am a blessing. I am blessed. observe internally what is being gifted to you in this time of simply allowing in the quiet. Explore. Reminded that you can return here anytime you need to be reminded of the power you have within, anytime you need to be reminded of who you are, anytime you need to feel the power of God's love, it is here, right here, at all times. Knowing, we say, thank you, God, for the reminder of the power of your presence, your grace, your love. Thank you, God, amen, amen, amen. Oh, that felt good. Forget my first Unity experience. It was almost 30 years ago, maybe 30. Yeah, maybe. You remember yours? Maybe it's today. I'll never forget it because I'd been searching, like we all have, from the time I was a child for something that made sense. Taught about. Am I coming in and out, or is that just me? No, am I back on? Okay. The guy I was taught about didn't seem to make sense to me. I keep going in and out. Let me see if it's me. No, it couldn't be me. Sometimes it is. Most of the time it is. No,
nothing seemed to fit. But I remember wanting to give my daughter, particularly, my stepkids were a little older, but particularly give her some sort of a foundation, some sort of an understanding of God. So I drug that poor child through every church in Citrus County, and there'd be something that'd just go, and my poor daughter would say, oh, I just made friends in the nursery. What's going on now? What did he say? I'd be like, honey, I can't. I just can't. And I remember my first Unity experience. The first thing I felt when I kind of snuck in the back thinking, what's going on here? These people look awful happy. What's happening? Interesting, I was suspicious of that. All of a sudden, I started feeling like I'd come home. Something incredibly familiar. And then I couldn't stop crying. The floodgates just opened. And I'll never forget Gail, who came to be one of my dearest spiritual sisters, mothers. Gail Rice was singing. She was later on to be our choir leader, but at that time, it's just a tiny little church, and she was doing the song leading and the announcements and that. And she started singing Surely the Presence. I had never heard that song before. And the way she was singing it was grabbing me and holding me. Because she wasn't singing to us. She wasn't singing with us. She wasn't singing to God. She was singing in her own awareness of knowing that surely God is in this place, like nothing I had ever experienced. She was so convinced that I started to believe her right there and then that God was here. And it shook me to my core. I thought, what's happening? And I went home and I'm trying to describe it to my husband. And I'm like, something, I don't know. I was intrigued by the name, Unity. I don't remember who the minister was or gave the talk. I don't remember. I just remember feeling something so powerful that I just couldn't shake for that whole week. And then I thought, well, I'm going to go back next week and just see what's really going on here. Same thing. I started crying all over again. And then I couldn't get enough. Then I wanted to read everything there was in that place. Then I wanted to figure it all out. And then I started understanding the messaging, because it was just enough different than what I had been taught that I started to think. One of the things I noticed right away was that Unity doesn't teach you what to think at all, but more how to think. And I thought I was a really good thinker. And I hadn't realized that some of my thinking was hindering me from experiencing this God that Gail understood. I want to read something that kind of sums it up in our collective experience of the circumstances in which we are raised. It's called I Am Light. What is this acumen we've developed to describe our terrors? Why are our stories of pain so well carved and whittled? Why these PhD certificates of our errors hanging all over ourselves? No matter what the degree of joy of beauty, why not give ourselves over to that? No matter how far we are from where we are aiming to go, why not look at it differently? Why not say, I am light, building a kingdom of myself? This is what Unity was teaching me. I began to pay hyper-focus on what I was telling myself, what the world was telling me from the time I was this big. I remember being really mad at God for supposedly taking my father out of the picture. Many of you can relate to that and some of the circumstances that put us in. So I blamed God because that's what I was trained to do. Maybe I wasn't praying hard enough. Maybe I wasn't good enough. They would tell me God needed him more. What? That's preposterous. I don't want anything to do with a God that needs him more than me. What kind of a strong God is that, right? And I hadn't really realized that some of that thinking I wasn't even conscious of. And it occurred to me that some of the discussions in those intelligent rooms, college dorms and that I were having, were hyper-focused on the negative. even in the deepest scientific realms, which were lovely and wonderful, there is still this element of doom. And I love those conversations. And I still engage in them, but with a different viewpoint. Einstein reminded us, and many great mystic physics instructors teach us, the human brain is capable of so much creativity, we haven't even begun to unleash it. Things that the human brain can bring about just by the way God has wired it is phenomenal. How much time are we spending not knowing this, not recognizing it, not focusing on it? What are we creating out of this extraordinary thing that God has devised in us? What are we creating? Sorrows? Tragedy? Gloom and doom? What are we seeing? And what do we want to see? Unity helped me understand there's another way to look at things. One of the great things I love about Unity is Unity puts it in your lap. The teacher might open the door, but you got to walk through it. If you want. Charles Fillmore reminded us that Unity holds shallows that a child can splash in, yet depths that a giant must swim. So we know that we can turn to these tools when the water gets deep and turbulent. So over the next 5 or 6 weeks, I'm going to be talking a lot about Unity, where Unity came from, why, what its purpose is, where are we going, what's happening, why are these tools so important, why are they so profound, how do they work so efficiently. We're going to go over the five principles, the basic tenets of Unity, the 12 powers and why we focus on that, what that's about, some of the other extraordinary work from Charles. And just a little bit, just to kind of break the ice with Unity. Unity was co-founded by two extraordinary teachers who couldn't be more polar opposite, really. They both had somewhat Christian upbringings. Myrtle's father was a Methodist bishop, preacher. Myrtle was incredibly intelligent. She went to Oxford College at a time when women were, they say, discouraged, forbidden to go. Charles was raised near the Chickasha Reservation, was stolen for a few days by them, and then brought back when he was a young child, around 4. They had this love of poetry, of knowledge, of understanding. They wrote letters to each other when they were separated with passages from books from the Transcendentalists, and they were just hungry, but they remained completely together on this understanding that it is through our diversity as a human species that we are strongest and most beautiful. So they built Unity, the orchards that began as a place to come together and study, with the concept of bringing teachers, preachers, ministers, doctors, the leaders together to recognize it is in our differences where we grow and thrive and have our existence in true enjoyment. And that is what they started with. Myrtle was the mother of Unity with her work in healing. She was not expected to live past 40. She had an extraordinary experience and started to recognize it was in her thinking and these principles that they were beginning to carve through the teachings of Jesus, which was extraordinary in that time. She and Charles were much more interested in Jesus' work and his actions and what he was instilling to the people of the time than the thought that he was some sort of a savior and it's only him, and if he doesn't come back, then what are we to do? That didn't impress them as much as the life he led and what he had to teach. So they spent their life emulating those teachings they use the Bible as a metaphysical guide to life, how we can learn from some of those prophets, how we can learn from that idea that some of those teachers presented, but they understood that the Bible is simply man's understanding of God through evolution, and what those ancient tribes thought about God to modern day, which we are finding those ancient tribes kind of had it more realistically than modern times, I would say. So we're going to explore some of those early teachings and why unity is so desperately needed right now on this planet. The words say it themselves, unity. One of the things that I was so drawn to, and my entire family was the concept of inclusivity. No one's left out of the kingdom. No one. Nothing you have ever done can keep you from God. God is in and through you, not some guy in the sky somewhere that decides if you're behaving based on what church you go to. That appealed to me. No, I never believed that. The extraordinary maestro and creator of all that ever was, is, and gonna be cares what you did last Saturday night? Come on. I mean, it never made any sense. Unity puts it in a way that brings everybody in. The entire human species are children of God, regardless of where you were born, what color your skin is, what political affiliation you are, what your sexual orientation are. It doesn't matter to God. You are an incredible creature created by the Creator, fashioned in a way that you have access to things you can't even dream of. Why are you focusing on anything but that? Why are you focusing on anything less than your greatness? And unity teaches these tools to access that greatness. That's exciting to me still. It still makes me weep. And I know when I get hit with a challenge, buckle up. Mm-hmm. I get out my material and I settle in. Because I know. And for someone like me, I'm Thomas. I'm the doubter. Show me. I'm not going to believe your words. Show me. And let me experience it, because I don't know it till I experience it. You can teach someone what a hot fudge sundae tastes like. You can tell them, oh, it's cool and it's warm and it's creamy and it's delicious and it's sweet and it's so great. But you can't know what that is until you bite it, can you? You can't imagine what that tastes like until you know it. And then you're like, how many of you have had a spiritual experience that has shooken you to your core and you just know it? Right. And we just know it. Can you describe it? No. Can you verify it? No. Do you care? No. Are you ever going to forget it? No. Do you want more of it? Yes. And how to get there. And unity, and I throw in a lot of sprinklings of Hindu and Buddhism, and we're all creating a religion of our own. And I rely on some of the old parts of that old religion that I grew up in because they were such a strong family. And I think that's important. And our rituals and customs, those are important too. But these five basic principles will answer every challenge you have in life. And we're going to go through each one of them over these next few weeks. But basically they are, the first one, God is everywhere present. There is no place God is not. The sap that goes up in the tree, the tear that comes down your cheek, the velvet on a plant petal, God is everywhere. It is that energy, that life force energy. There's no place God is not. Just knowing that, how can you worry? How can you sink back into tragedy and fear and worry? You know, oh my God, what's going to happen if the right people don't get in and get elected? That can overwhelm us. First principle, God is. The second principle, anybody want to say it? On the octopa? Any of you studying for finals in ministerial school, just remember octopa. Only one God, one power, one presence. C. What is the C? The Christ present is in every single person. The Christ presence is there. If you know you're going to go to the grocery store and meet Christ at the register, how are you going to act? Be nice. That says it all. You know you're going to go and Christ is going to be there. Be nice. That Christ potential is in every single human being. And in you, by the way, and in you, whenever you start thinking small, and have you ever noticed when you're not thinking God thoughts, you're like this? And see what you're missing when you're like this and you're scared to do that? Instead of like this, how many of you did the homework? Do you remember what it was? Yes, did you do it? Some days, thank you, some days, thank you. Surely did I know. Thank you. And it was simply to jump up in the morning and say, thank you, God. Look in the mirror and say, beautiful, I'm fantastic. There's nobody like me on the planet. Thank God. But there's nobody like me on the planet. I'm that amazing and that special. Thoughts held in mind are power. We know this now in subatomics. For those of you, and Unity draws a lot of scientists, a lot of thinkers, and we don't want you to check your brain at the door. We want you to challenge these things and test them yourself. Thoughts hold tremendous power. What you're putting out there is coming back to you. And I'm not talking about just the thoughts that run through your mind. I'm talking about those power thoughts that make you feel, as a man thinketh in his heart, so shall he be. So everything you are speaking, thinking, feeling, and acting is a prayer. And we're going to talk about that, how your words, Maya Angelou was one of the best examples of the power of words. And you all know about that experience. You know, she used to host these great parties with all these influencers, all these people. And at this one particular party, there was a gentleman, I don't know who it was, that was telling a joke of some sort that was very off color. And she just walked up and said, did you bring a coat? And he was like, and she said, let's go get it. I don't have that here in my home. And the entire crowd was like, and she said, words have power. They sink into the fabric on the couch. They sink into the paint on the wall, into the fabric of the drapes. They change the energy in a room. They have power. Everything you think, everything you speak, everything you do, and everything you feel is a prayer. So we're going to do an entire talk about that and how to set yourself up to be more high-minded and higher consciousness. Anybody know what the fourth one is? Two important things we do all the time, every Sunday. Prayer and meditation, thank you. Two distinctly different. And yes, there's no wrong way to pray, but there's an effective way to pray. We're going to talk about that. And meditation, of course, is going within. There's a zillion ways to meditate, but it's simply going within, becoming still, so you can listen. In prayer, we are activating the prayer, activating the energy. In meditation, we are listening. And what's the fifth, which is the most important, because the other four are just philosophy if we're not doing it? Action. Get to work. Work the work. Pray and move your feet. I have another assignment. This one is so fun. I had another one until I read Alan Cohen this morning. I get his little spiritual wisdom, daily spiritual wisdom, Alan Cohen. You all remember him. It's been a while probably since he's had something out. But this is so perfect for us. This is the best assignment because it's hard to do, but it's fun. Seek to wear life like a loose garment. Can we do that? Do you understand what that means? Seek to live life, just these 7 days, like a loose garment. I want to hear what you're hearing throughout the week, what that means to you, because that's really powerful. Okay? It's going to be for good discussion, too. And I just want to end with a short prayer from a dear rabbi friend of mine that just reminds us of who we are. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Grant me the impetus to go out of doors every day so that I may be with the trees and with the grass to remember to whom I belong. Thank you, God. Namaste. Amen. Amen.
It's now time for our blessing of tithes and offerings. So if the ushers will come forth, and we together will say our blessing. divine love flowing in and through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. And I am grateful. The presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel the mighty power and God's grace. There's a whole okay, we'll have the blessing on the prayer box. If you've never used the prayer box, try it sometime. It's usually kept on the credenza back there by the door. And you can put in a prayer of petition. You can put in a prayer of thanksgiving. And those prayers are prayed on at Unity Village for 30 days. Well, first they're prayed here by the chaplains. Then they're sent to Unity Village where they're prayed for another 30 days. And God does answer prayers. Not always the way we want, but he does answer prayer. So, Lord God, Mother, Father God, thank you for the faith of each person who has put a prayer into the prayer box. We know that you were in charge and all is well, and the outcomes will be part of your divine will. Amen. And we want to bring in children if there are any. Do we have any children with us? No children today? Okay. But if you're new, know that children are welcome. And our prayer chaplain today is Joanne Long, who's standing up in the back with the stole on. And she will be up here in the front after service if you would like one-on-one prayer. And again, prayer helps. Okay. If Joanne happens to be busy and you see another person with a purple stole on, you can go to them for prayer. Since there are no children, let's just bless ourselves because we're all children of God. Okay. We love you. We bless you. We behold the Christ in you. You, we appreciate you. Now, other announcements are blessing of visitors. Do we have any visitors that are here for the first time? Oh, good, we do have. All right. We would like to give you a blessing, and our ushers will give you a packet of material. So let's say our blessing for the visitors. We love you. And visitors, I'd like to let you know that after the service, we have coffee, carbs, and conversation. And that goes on out in the hallway where we have a few snacks. And it's now time for another quote from Martin Luther King. He said, "People fail to get along because they don't know each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. They don't know each other because they fail to communicate with each other." So we have a chance every Sunday to get together and communicate with each other. So while you're having your coffee, say hello to somebody. Maybe somebody you've never met, maybe somebody who's here for the first time, so that we can communicate and get to know each other. Okay, another announcement to remind everyone, this doesn't feel like it's on, but Daniel Namod will be here Saturday, January 27th for a concert at 1 o'clock. This is a free will offering and everyone is welcome. Also, Shirley reminded me that the tithe letter, for anybody who's getting ready to do their taxes, those letters will be available next Sunday. And are there any other announcements? Okay, if you didn't hear Joanne, the book club is discussing the book called Many Lives, Many Masters. And it is going to meet on Wednesday from 12:30 to 2. No, sorry, Sunday. Well, okay, the 28th. Good. Good, I'm glad somebody knows what's going on. Is there anybody else who has an announcement? Okay. You know, during her teaching, Lori mentioned about how the brains come together. You've got your left brain and your right brain. It's been a long time now, more than 25 years. But I had a very severe brain injury and was not expected to live. So how mine came together again and healed, there might be a few cracks, and that's why. But it does go to show you we can heal and God is good. And anyway, I'm able to function, and I praise God for that. All right, I think we will say our prayer for protection. So if you're able, stand. If you're not able, that's okay. We still love you. All right, the light of...